it's so good to see you all. Linda and I will be gone for a little while, but hopefully our cell phones will still work if you need anything, and I know that there'll still be folks around here, whatever goes on, and we'll be actually in Spain and Portugal and the Azores and on a boat. And we'll be actually on the boat coming back for like 6 days. And I'm hoping that we'll still be happily married when we get back. But we'll see about that. Yeah. Other announcements?
I'm just going to remind everybody tonight is bingo. Actually, it's in this afternoon, 4 o'clock. So be sure you come. Lots of prizes for winners and that kind of thing, and treats. And then next weekend, next Sunday, then is the Fall Festival, where we'll have all the little booths for the children. And Chrissy has gotten Kona Ice to come. So they're going to have their big truck out there. I didn't even know what that was. But she said all the kids know because they go to all the schools. And it's a truck with snow cones, basically. You get a shaved ice, and then the children get to go to the serving line or whatever and mix their own flavors or whatever they want to do. You know, and so that it's a big deal for kids. So we'll have that there, too. That's going to be a real neat thing. And, of course, then there'll be the hot dogs. So, Kyle, right? Hot dogs. Next week. Yes. You couldn't hear?
I can't hear anything back here.
Oh, okay. But anyway, we certainly invite you to come. We know that there's many of you that are going to help Chrissy with the booths, and we appreciate that. Carolyn Lasky is doing balloon animals, which is the coolest thing, and so we'll have ring toss. I don't know what else she knows, but anyway, y'all be sure and reserve that time, too. So this weekend is a big weekend, and next weekend is a big weekend so for our church, and then just the Saturday following Halloween is our quilt show, which is really going to be the coolest thing, I think, it's our gift to the community. And we'll have quilts draped over the pews in here, and then there'll be quilts in the Clark Hall and some things for sale. So please come. It's going to be just the neatest thing. So anyway, that's it, I think. Anybody else have anything? Okay, thanks, sir.
Please be in a spirit of prayer as we have our acolytes come forward to light the candles.
First, let me set the organ.
Thank you. Good morning. It's so exciting to hear everything that we were just told about what's coming up in our church in the next month, so I hope that we all can participate in that. But I have a little challenge for you this morning. I want to pose a question to you and have you think about it for just a minute. Now here's the question. Listen carefully. What does service to others mean individually to you? Now as you're thinking, different things might enter your mind as to what can I be of service to others. And it might simply be that you're trying to make things better for someone else. In 1 Thessalonians 5:15, it says, make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Sometimes service to others might just be a simple little thing like taking the grocery cart back into the store or picking up something that someone has dropped or giving a call and just checking on a friend, making a phone call to someone that's been sick or in the hospital, or just patiently taking the time to listen to a small child or an elderly person who needs to speak. We never know what these small acts of kindness will change the day or even the life of someone that needs a change. And it really costs us nothing. Nothing but the deliberate intention to do good. And here at our church, you have the opportunity to be of service to others through participation in our many different ministries. Just listen to all of these that are available to you. Our relationship ministry, worship, children and youth, the study ministry, our prayer ministry, art ministry, evangelism, and missions. So put this date on your calendar, Thursday, November the 4th at 5:30. We're having a ministry session, so you can ask questions and just learn a little bit more and hear in detail from the leaders of these different ministries what's involved and what suggestions you might have to have them grow and be bigger service to our church and to our community. In Isaiah 6:8, we are encouraged. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then I said, here I am, Lord, send me. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we pray now that you will help us to keep our service to others uppermost in our minds. Help us to not miss an opportunity to help others. We do, however, need your help and your guidance every day. By helping others, we pray that we are in some small part doing your work. We pray these things in your name. Amen.
Thank you.
forward for the children's moment.
Hi, guys. How are y'all? Awesome. What a beautiful morning it is, huh? Yeah. All right. So I have a question for you guys this morning, and I need you to hold this for me. Okay, have a bowl. What's in it? There's water in it, right? Okay. Is that all? Do you see anything else? Well, that's the carpet underneath. Do you see anything else in the bowl? Yeah, we just see clear water. That's it. You know what? Does someone want to reach in there? See if there's anything else in there? I mean, I see just water. Anybody else? All right, you can both do that. Oh, wow, whoa. She goes, I don't see anything, but wow, that's cool. Yeah, so when you reach in there, you actually see these little beads. Cool. Here's a rag. You can wipe your hands off. There you go. So sometimes things look invisible, but they can be there. So think about that. Let's take our hands out for a minute now. Think about that. Sometimes when we're at school or we're with some friends, even our best friends sometimes, we feel invisible sometimes, don't we? They may not always hear what we have to say, or our opinion doesn't always seem like it makes sense. Or sometimes our friend just starts playing with somebody else and we're like, what? What happened? Or somebody gets recognized at school and you don't. And you're doing the same good stuff, you're doing the same good grades. It just doesn't seem like it's always happening, huh? Sometimes we feel invisible. But you know what? Just like these beads, you're not. They are there. You are always there. And someone will see you. You want to know who it is? Jesus will see you. When you feel invisible, what should you probably do? Pray. Say, God, I need some help today. I know I'm not invisible. I know I can be seen. Help me be who you need me to be. You can always pray to him, because guess what? He's always there. And he will always be in that unseen place. And you know what? He seems invisible to us, doesn't he? But is he always there? He is. And it's hard to remember that, because it's hard to remember something that you can't see. Right? I mean, think about that. When I'm in a hard spot, sometimes I'm just having a bad day. Sometimes things just aren't going well. It's sometimes very hard to remember to pray, because God is not sitting right beside me, and we can't just pray together. But I have to remember that, you know what, we can. He is there, and he is invisible, but yet his presence is there. He's in my heart. He lives there, and I know that that is true. Do you want to pray with me today as we try to remember that about ourselves? Okay, bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come today and to remember that, you know what? It doesn't matter how invisible we feel sometimes, because you know our hearts. You know who we are. You made us. You know exactly who we're supposed to be. We just have to remember that about ourselves. Thank you, Father, for allowing us the opportunity to be able to remember that and to also pray to you and love you and be with you. Father, we ask that you take our hearts and you live in them and you be with us always. We pray this in your holy and blessed name. Amen.
generation is we get a little bit holiday deprived because we don't celebrate what some others do because our founders felt like there was too much fancy stuff going on and they wanted to keep it simple. But there's one day that I think we might think about. And if I were going to be here next weekend, we might actually kind of celebrate what's called the Day of the Dead. Over these last couple of years, I don't know about you, but I have lost friends. I've lost people that I know. And what I would normally ask that we do is maybe set out some tables in the fellowship hall and bring things to remind us of those folks who have gone. But instead of that, today what I'd like to do is I'm going to kind of go around, and if you have someone, friend, relative, acquaintance, who's passed away in the last couple of years, if you would say their name, and then if the rest of us would repeat together, we pray in the name of Jesus. Excuse me? We pray in the name of Jesus. Others? Yes. We pray in the name of Jesus. 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 Others? We pray in the name of Jesus. 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 Others? Yeah. We pray in the name of Jesus. Others? We pray in the name of Jesus. 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 Others? Yes, ma'am. We pray in the name of Jesus. We pray in the name of Jesus. Yes. We pray in the name of Jesus. We pray in the name of Jesus. Let's join our hearts in prayer. Precious Lord, for those names that we have called out, and for the many who have come to be with you over the last couple of years, we pray with all of our hearts that they will live on in the lives of others. We know that those whose names have been spoken this day touch the hearts of others. And we know that it is your intention that we have full and complete lives, now and forevermore. Lord, we cry when we lose those we love, but we rejoice that theirs is not an end, that they will live on in your kingdom. Lord, we ask that you be with each of us in our sorrows, in our discontent, in our efforts to become closer to you. We ask that we might come to you as we leave this world. We pray that you forgive our trespasses. We pray that we have forgiven others. We pray that we might be a part with you of the kingdom of God forever and ever. As we stand and we repeat together the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Please pray with me. Precious Lord, I pray that the significance of the words of Isaiah might shine forth through the message today. For it is your words and your thoughts that Isaiah presented to the world. We ask this in your name. Amen. 1947. Little boy throwing rocks in the desert of Israel. Out in some really, you think we've got desert in West Texas? We're talking real desert near the Dead Sea. Place called Qumran. He throws a rock, and instead of kind of a soft sound against the sand, he hears a thunk. Well, let's see what that's all about. So he goes and he digs a little, and son of a gun, but there is a jar, a big jar, an earthen jar. And this kid is smart enough to know that there's a whole lot of people back in Jerusalem willing to pay good money for this kind of thing. So he digs it up some, but guess what? There are scrolls inside of that earthen jar. And there's more than one jar. And people get real excited. And these are what came to be known as the Dead Sea Scrolls. In among those was a complete copy of the book of Isaiah. We're talking at least 2,000 years after Jesus Christ. These scrolls were written prior to the crucifixion. They were written sometime before the birth of Jesus Christ. And they have in them this document on animal skins that's 27 feet long. It's written without any punctuation. Did you ever read something without punctuation? It's a little hard sometimes to know exactly what was meant. But it's continuously written for 27 feet, which is part of why I think it's kind of amazing that Jesus had the ability to take a scroll and point to the part that he wanted to talk about, because it wouldn't have been easy to roll that 27 feet. I have some guesses about where these things came from. We don't know a lot of what went on in the life of Jesus Christ during the time between his childhood and the time that he began preaching. It is thought, and there's many different ideas of how these scrolls came to be and who did them. Well, I suggest to you that there was a sect called the Essens, and they were kind of monastic. They lived out in the desert. They lived very humbly. And they transcribed scripture. Well, I wonder what the possibilities are that during some of that time that Jesus was in the world, and we don't know exactly what he was doing. Maybe he was with the essence, and maybe he was learning Old Testament scripture by copying it and making copies for temples around the area of Israel. That's a possibility. I do think it would be kind of interesting if you go to Israel, one of the things you'll see is this 27-foot scroll, and it's all laid out for you in this nice little round thing. Wouldn't it be interesting if that scripture from Isaiah happened to have been copied by Jesus, and that would be the centerpiece of the Jewish museum? But that's just pure speculation. I believe in God. I believe in Jesus Christ. I believe in the Holy Spirit, and part of that has to do with the sheer impossibility of Isaiah 800 years before Jesus Christ knowing a lot about what was coming up with Jesus. I want to go through some of the actual words written by Isaiah, and you may have a different interpretation to some of these words than I do. But I encourage you to spend some time with the book of Isaiah. It, as we've talked about last week, it may have been written by more than one person, probably three. But back then, it wasn't unusual for a significant person like Isaiah to have disciples. And it wasn't unusual for the disciples to continue their work in their name. So even though the book of Isaiah covers about 300 years, that doesn't mean that somebody plagiarized or stole the name. That just means that people that followed in the footsteps of Isaiah helped him out and put his words down as things happened. But the words themselves are, to me, almost scary, because this is Isaiah 7:14. Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the young woman is with child and shall bear a son and shall name him Emmanuel. Emmanuel means God with us. A child will be born whose name is God with us. 800 years prior to the birth of Jesus Christ. Did God come to people a little differently back then? Was Isaiah so into the idea of God that he could decipher that these things were going to happen? I don't know for sure. But I do know that the fact that Isaiah had a good idea of what was going to be coming over the next few centuries means to me that God was at work. And people who were tuned in to the signs could tell that something important was going to happen. Isaiah 9:12. The people who have walked in the darkness have seen a great light. For the yoke of their burden you have broken. It was a very difficult time in the kingdom of Judea. As we've talked about, the Assyrians were ready to come down and take over. Beyond that, Babylon was ready to come in and take over Assyria. And beyond that, Persia was going to come in and take over everybody. So there were wars and rumors of wars. It wasn't a great time in the history of Judea. And of course, eventually they fell. And eventually, most of the people who were anybody ended up being captives in Babylon. And it wasn't until a man named Cyrus, the leader of Persia, decided that, well, there might be something to God. Maybe we ought to just pay homage to God. And he released the prisoners, and he even participated a little bit in the rebuilding of the Second Temple about 500 years before Christ. The people had a yoke. The people had a burden. You think our inflation is bad now? They had inflation back then. They had to wonder when they got up in the morning whether or not one of these armies was going to come in and destroy their homes. For a child has been born for us, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. If that sounds familiar to you, that's because that's also repeated more than once in the New Testament. 87 times Isaiah is quoted in the New Testament. Jesus knew the book of Isaiah. Jesus knew how to bring out things that Isaiah had said that were a part of the Jewish history. And Jesus could use these statements of Isaiah to help people understand what was going on and that this was something important and different going on. I don't know how Becky found this song that you heard this morning about the root of Jesse. Does anybody know what the root of Jesse is? David the king. Jesse is David's father. So the root of Jesse means that family of David, that it was so important that the Messiah to come had a connection with the house of David. And that connection came through Jesus. On that day, the root of Jesse shall stand as a signal to the peoples. The nations shall inquire of him, and his dwelling shall be glorious. Something significant was going to happen, and it was going to be in the line of David. Now, I understand we're talking a virgin birth here, so it's a little difficult to see how that's all connected, but we know that Jesus' earthly father was a part of the progeny of David. Therefore, thus says the Lord, I am laying in Zion a foundation stone, a tested stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation. How many times have we heard Jesus described as the cornerstone, that building block? something is going to happen in Judea that's going to be the foundation for something important to come. A voice cries out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight the desert a highway for our God. And this has most often been associated with John the Baptist as preparing that way of the Lord. And we'll be talking more about that as we go through some of these prophecies. Here is my servant whom I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights. I put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the nations. A bruised reed he will not break. He will faithfully bring forth justice. That idea of bringing forth justice began with way back when Moses was about to enter the promised land and said to the people gathered there to cross over, what does the Lord require of you? What the Lord requires is for people to do justice. That is the price of the promised land. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole. And by his bruises, we are healed. For me, this is kind of difficult because I've often said to God and myself, I never asked that Jesus Christ be crucified for my sake. You and I don't like other people doing things for us. We want to be independent and do it ourselves. But the only way that we find salvation is by accepting God's mercy. We can be wonderful or horrible, but without God's mercy, nothing good is going to happen. I had picked out a couple of scriptures that carry this same thought. Jesus our Lord, who was handed over to death for our trespasses and was raised for our justification. That's Romans 4:25. Did you ever see an old movie or something and somebody, I'm justified. Took me a long time to figure that one out. How can I justify being a part of God's world? I'm a sinner. I've done a lot of things that I wished I hadn't done. But through the mercy of Jesus Christ, the scales are balanced. They're justified through God's mercy. Another one was in 1 Peter 2:24. By his wounds you have been healed. for you were going astray like a sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. Jesus Christ was wounded for you. You might not have asked him to do it, but your justification, the balancing of your scales, happened because of the wounds of Jesus Christ. By a perversion of justice, he was taken away. That nails the occurrences of what happened to Jesus Christ. He got crucified as a perversion of justice. That's Isaiah 53:8. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence. If you've been to Israel, you've probably been to something called the Garden Tomb, and that's where rich people were buried. That was very likely the place that Jesus Christ was laid to rest and rose from the dead, with rich people. How did Isaiah have any concept of that 800 years before? I love this passage. For I am about to create a new heaven and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind. Do you remember the book of Revelation? A new heaven and a new earth. Something very different is going to happen with Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is bringing to the world 800 years later a new way for us to come to God through love, not through violence, not because we have to, but because God loves us so much that God is sending God's Son. And the wolf and the lamb shall feed together. The lion shall eat straw like the ox, but the serpent, its food shall be dust, and they shall not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, says the Lord. What a wonderful paragraph. Good things are coming. Good things are going to happen. If it's not a happy ending, it's not the ending yet. God wants for each of us the best. God wants for us a happy, fulfilled relationship with God. I've often tried to use that with my son as to why it was important for him to have a relationship with God first and a church second. Because this very church gives me such a sense of comfort and joy. I loved last week. If you're not getting some of those text messages that involve the church, I don't know who was up at 3 o'clock in the morning, but somebody was texting, and it was really interesting. And it showed me that you all live and love with each other in a way that had to make God smile just as much as it made me smile. It is a beautiful thing to have a family. And to have a family of God. Let's pray. Precious Lord, it's sometimes difficult for us to understand the words that come to us from your patriarchs and your prophets. But we know that they saw signs. Lord, help us to see the signs that tell us that Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior, now and forevermore. Amen. Please prepare your hearts for communion. Whose table is this? Who is invited to this table? Let us pray.
Heavenly Father, let us be strong. Have wisdom and speak softly. We must be faithful and keep our justice fair and swift, for the chosen one is coming. We look forward to our Savior's return and honor him by taking the bread, the symbol of his broken body.
Heavenly Father, as we come before you, we remember the words of the hymn, "Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for sinners such as I?" We come before you confessing that we're the sinners that Christ died for, and we ask you to bless this cup that represents the blood that was shed on Calvary's cross for our forgiveness of sins and eternal life. We ask these things in his name. Amen.
I remind you that you need not be a member of this church or our denomination. All are invited to join us in this service of communion. Even as on that night that our Lord Jesus Christ was betrayed, and he took the bread, and he held it, and he blessed it, and he broke it, and he said to those gathered, "This is my body, which is given for you. Eat of this whenever you're together in remembrance of me." In like manner, our Lord Jesus Christ took the cup, and he held it, and he blessed it, and he passed it to those gathered with him. And he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for many for the forgiveness of sin. Drink of this whenever you're together in remembrance of me." The table of the Lord is prepared. Please come. couple of times on ships, I have been asked to preach, so I'll have a sermon ready just in case. I know that you all have three very good folk who will be here, and do come and listen to them. And this day, if God so moves you to come forward to place a membership with this church, or just because you need that extra blessing, come forward as we stand and sing our song of invitation. Please stand as we sing.